just so thankful that you're here to worship with us this morning. We do have a few things that we need to make you aware of in the life of our church. This Wednesday, May the 4th, we will have our end-of-year program for our children's choirs. That will be at 6:15, and we invite everybody in the church to come celebrate with them. And then the following week, on May the 11th, will be the end-of-year program for all of our missions organizations. So again, 6:15 on Wednesday night, come and celebrate with those groups as they share what they've done this year. If you're a guest with us this morning, would you please do us a favor of looking at the pew in front of you and grabbing one of the visitor cards that someone's already done for us. Fill that out and give us some information so that we can follow up with you this week and give you a thanks for being with us this morning. Now is an opportunity for us as believers and followers of Jesus Christ to turn our hearts and minds to the Lord. Let's worship Him together today in spirit and in truth.
Good morning. So good to see everybody here this morning. We are just glad that we can be together to worship the Lord today. Let's take an opportunity. Let's stand together. I know in my life it's a little chaotic on Sunday morning. Let's take an opportunity to greet and welcome one another, shake some hands and hug some necks this morning.
I invite you to join with us as we sing.
Thank you so much for the bond of love that you've given us, Lord, that we can come this morning in unity, focused on you, thankful for all the many blessings that you've given us and all the many things that you do in our lives. Lord, I just pray for those that are maybe hurting right now, those that are going through difficulties, that we would realize that that love is here, the love that you have is for them and not against them. Lord, thank you so much for all that you're going to do today as we come together all because of you. That we would focus in on the scripture, focus in as we sing all the many things that you give us in ways that we can praise you and glorify your name. We just pray that we would do it in an attitude of thankfulness, a spirit ready to receive what you have for us. And Lord, just help us to be once again doers of your word and not just hearers. Lord, be with us this morning and that we would feel your presence through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray.
On our journey following the Lord. Trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can. Good morning, boys and girls. Let's have a children's sermon.
Hymn is number 386. I invite you to stand as we sing the first and the last stanzas of Brethren, We Have Met to Worship.
Acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. As we sang this morning, bowing the knee, and as we have sang the other songs this morning, we are not worthy to stand in God's presence. Our offerings and our gifts are nothing to him. But through him, we can use those to affect and show the love that we have for one another to those who are in the world. So as we come this morning to receive these tithes and the offerings, just ask that you would pray for them, that they would be used the way that God wants them to be used for those who need them most. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today on this day of worship. We thank you for your wonderful blessings in our lives. We thank you for the ability to make it to our worship building this morning. We are grateful for all of those who have gathered with us today. We are so thankful for the blessings that you've bestowed upon us. We ask that you continue to pour out your grace and your love and your mercy upon us as we go throughout these days ahead. We just ask your blessings upon this offering, Lord, and we just ask that you take the tithes, the offerings, and you would use them, Lord, as unworthy as they may be, to forward your kingdom here on this earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I invite you now to turn to number 385, and let's stand together as we sing all four stanzas of They'll Know We Are Christians, number 385.
And they'll Father, what a powerful truth we have been reminded of this morning. The importance of each other. Father, you have blessed us with a great family of believers here at Bowdon. Lord, as we love on each other, the world will know that there's something different about this group of believers. They will know that we are Christians because of our love. Father, today I ask that you would help us to really examine our own lives. That not only will the world know that we are Christians by our love, but Father, we will know that we are Christians because of the love that we have for each other. Father, as always, as we come before you at this moment, we ask for your help. The reality is I can accomplish absolutely nothing. Through you, all things are possible. Father, I pray that you would speak to our hearts and minds this morning, that one that's here that's not sure of their eternal security, or they would make that decision. And Father, those of us that have that walk and we know that we would understand the role and responsibility we have towards one another. Father, we just ask again, your Holy Spirit, move and work again, that we would not just be hearers, but we would be doers. For we ask and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you have your Bibles, I hope you've already turned to 1 John chapter number 3. If you have not, please be doing so. So Emma stood up here and asked this morning what we're afraid of. I'm afraid of nails. If you can't see that, there is a wound on my hand, and my wife said, "Where's your Band-Aid?" I left my Band-Aid at home. So this morning, if I give you the left hand of Christian fellowship, the right elbow of Christian fellowship, or the fist bump of Christian fellowship, that's just I'm trying to keep this thing safe. So I just want to let you guys know that. I'm not being offensive. I'm not being rude. I'm not being disrespectful. My hand hurts really bad this morning. This morning as I went downstairs to wake Sydney up, she said, "Dad, is that a pink tie?" "Yeah, it's a pink tie to go with my pink socks." I didn't know that I had anything that matched those socks. Jill's like, "I didn't know you had those socks." It is so good to be here with the body of Christ this morning to celebrate. And that's where John wants us to get our understanding, that we know that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, that we know that we have eternal life because we love each other. As I talk about my fear of my hand and the nails, as I maybe talk about my fear of pink ties, the real fear that I've testified of for weeks in this pulpit is the fear of man. The reality is when we walk away this morning, I want everybody to love me and to think, "Man, that was awesome. What we heard this morning was great." And the reality is that's not going to happen. I'm preaching God's word. I'm preaching the Bible. There are truths in here that are offensive. There are things that hurt our feelings. There are things that we don't like. And so the reality is I've got to get over that fear. And I want to go ahead and confess this morning. One of the ways that God has blessed me over the past few weeks to be able to get over that is the truth that we are learning in this passage of Scripture this morning. You guys have been loving on me and my family in ways that I cannot express thankfulness for. You guys are so awesome. I hear everywhere I go and everybody that I run into, "Man, Justin, we just love you and your family. We're so thankful that you're here at Bowdon. We're so thankful that God is using you. God is blessing us." And then I'll hear other people that are testifying of what other people are saying. "Hey, I ran into this person or that person. Man, they're saying good things about what's going on at Bowdon Baptist Church." Man, that will allay your feels real quickly. When everybody is saying, "Man, God is using you, and I know that you're praying, and everybody's working together for God's kingdom." But if you're one of those people this morning that doesn't fit into that category, would you please listen to this passage of Scripture this morning? John writes in 1 John chapter 3, beginning in verse 11, "For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's were righteous. Do not be surprised, brothers, that the world hates you. We know that we passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Whoever does not love abides in death. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or in talk, but in deed and in truth. By this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our hearts before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. Whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us. It is such a privilege and an honor to be with a group of people that loves one another. And it manifests itself in so many different ways. God has called us to a place where we're intentional about loving one another. We have already sung it this morning. I will remind you of it again in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. We've talked about it over and over and over again. The one thing that Satan wants to destroy is the unity in the body of Christ. And the one way he will not be able to do that is if we truly, genuinely love one another like the Bible has called us to. And the beautiful part of this is if we love each other that way, then people outside the four walls of this community of believers will go, you know what? Man, I want to be a part of that. Because the reality is out in the world, that's not what's going on. Most of you see that in your workplaces. People are not loving on one another and encouraging one another. Some of you are blessed to work in those environments where they do. But the reality is most people out there are not loving on one another. So if they see us loving one another, then they'll know that we're Christians. Here's the reality. I have a confession to make, and this is just a reality of how we do a good job of keeping the Bible in its context. Man, I really wanted to go into this passage this morning because I was like, man, we're going to talk about loving our brothers, and I wanted to talk about the universal brother. You know, the fact that we were all created in the image of God, that you go all the way back to tracing our family tree, and it all comes down to Adam and Eve. And I wanted to really kind of hone in on that because our culture is so segmented and it's so divided, and there's so much frustration and angst and anxiety because we're fighting against each other culturally, socially. It doesn't matter. There's so many places that we're fighting against each other. But if we keep the scripture the way we're supposed to in its context, that is not at all what John's talking about. John's talking about the community of believers, the brethren that are the followers of Jesus Christ. You know, the reality is, we have a hard enough time with that group of brothers, much less the brothers outside the four walls of the church, or the brothers and sisters that we work with in our places of employment. We have a hard enough time working on this group. So John's like, guys, you know that you've passed from death unto life. You know that you have been transformed by the work of the Holy Spirit because you love one another. So that's the question every one of us as individuals have to ask ourselves this morning is, do we love each other? Like 1 Corinthians tells us to, being patient and kind. Are we doing that? Are we being intentional about that? And I think it's so hilarious as I've been studying and prepping and going back and kind of reviewing where we've been and working towards where we're going. It's amazing how God has led us to Ephesians, where there was this idea of unity and making sure the body of Christ was strong in its unity. And now we go to 1 John, and man, I just sensed there was a need in affirmation in some of your lives. Some of you needed to be affirmed in your relationship with Jesus Christ, and that's why I sensed the Holy Spirit was leading us to 1 John. But it's amazing how much this conversation comes up over and over again about why it's important for us to be unified. because that's what Satan's after. I asked the guys in prayer room this morning to pray for a good friend of mine. This week I had the opportunity and privilege to share with a couple of guys at a funeral service. It's a good friend of mine from high school. Basically, I've shared his grandmother helped to raise me. But her oldest daughter's name was Shirley. And Shirley's house, we would go to her house after school. And I told him at the funeral, I said, I learned to love some things at Miss Shirley's house. One, I learned my love of SpaghettiOs. Those things are nasty. But man, every afternoon when I would come home from school, we would sit down at her house with those TV trays. And we would sit in front of the television. We would eat SpaghettiOs. The other thing I learned to love was TBS. Because we would come home, and they don't do this anymore. Well, there's Cartoon Networks now. But we would come home, and we could sit down in front of the television. We could eat SpaghettiOs, and we could watch cartoons. Like, we could watch kids' shows. But when we were asked to come and do this funeral, there were three preachers and another guy at the graveside. It's like, man, what are we going to talk about? How are we going to share? And I got up and shared my little personal stories of how she influenced me. And then the next guy was another good friend of ours, and he got up and did the same thing. And then her nephew got up, who's also, all four of us are pastors now. And we shared about the influence that she had on our life. She was a lifetime homemaker. She wasn't out in the community. She didn't have a loud voice. But there were four guys that stood at her funeral that are in positions of influence now as pastors of congregations because she showed us love. If it wouldn't have been for Aunt Shirley and Grandma Nell, I'd have been a latchkey kid. And I'd have to come home after school and lock myself in. But this lady loved on me. Well, as we were there together, one of the guys that was with us was the pastor of First Baptist Church of Villarica, Brother Kevin Williams. I asked our guys this morning in prayer room to pray for him. This morning they're having their groundbreaking service. They're about to break ground on a new Family Life Center at First Villarica. And those of you that are reading the papers or watching the news, Brother Kevin Williams, since he's been at First Baptist Church, has been under a lot of attack. Matter of fact, we walked in the funeral home Tuesday night. He said, well, guess who called me this afternoon? I said, who? He goes, Fox News. And I looked at Kevin. I said, what'd you do this time? But as we talked and the things that they're dealing with, the struggles they're facing, God is moving and working in the north end of our county. God is moving and working at First Baptist Church of Villarica, and of course, it would only stand to reason that the adversary would attack them. And one of the ways that he loves to attack is inside the body of Christ. He likes to come in and have people kind of bickering and complaining and fussing and fighting. And he even said thank you to me. He said, Justin, I appreciate you addressing one of my members a couple of weeks ago. They asked me a question about him. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. I'm not, that's not how we go. We all are in the same team. We're all on the same page. But if we're not being intentional about loving on this group of people, and not this just this group of people at Bowdon Baptist, but all of our brothers and sisters, we're going to run into problems. In church, guess where we are? We're in a mess in the world because we got a lot of bad PR because we're not loving on one another. He goes on to say this, and the way if you guys love filling in the blanks, I just put it this way, just to simplify it. Hate is the same as murder. How do we know that? Matthew chapter number 5. Jesus is trying to help those people in teaching them in the Sermon on the Mount, specifically those disciples. He comes out of what we call the Beatitudes, and he teaches them what a kingdom follower looks like. And then in that process of having that conversation, he then says, all right, guys, you've been told, you've heard it said that if you commit adultery, it's a sin. He said, but I say if you have lust in your heart, it's the same as adultery. And then he goes on and he has this conversation about hatred. He says, you've been told that if you commit murder, it is a sin. I tell you that if you have hatred in your heart, if you call someone a fool without just cause, it's the same as murder. So John tells us this story. He helps us to understand that the world is going to hate us. But we can't be like the world. We have to be different than the world. Says 13, don't be surprised, brother, if the world hates you. He goes back and he tells that story of Cain and Abel and John reminds his listener here that remember how it worked with Cain and Abel. Cain killed his brother. Why? Because he looked at the righteous deeds of his brother. The world hates us because we're doing what God's called us to do. And we can't fall into that same trap in the body of Christ. We need to be excited about what's going on at First Baptist Villarica. And it ought to break our heart when churches are struggling, when they can't find pastors, or there's bickering and complaining. We shouldn't glory in that or gloat over that. We ought to pray, and we ought to encourage, and we ought to strengthen. And that's why John's saying here, guys, as the body of Christ, we have to be different. The problem is we're not. That as much as they sit out and badmouth us at the local, well, they don't do it at the local coffee shop. They don't do that. But down at Jack's, a lot of times you can walk around and I just badmouthing the church, man, sitting there and saying bad things about the body of Christ. We can't be tearing each other down. We got to be building each other up. And that's why John says here, he says, guys, you got to understand that there's going to be this conflict. The world is going to hate you. The world is going to fight against you. That cannot happen here. We saw it all through the book of Ephesians. We're seeing it over and over and over again. John keeps bringing us back. He talks about how we know we're keeping God's commandments. How? Because we love our brothers. Have you seen that little thread woven through 1 John? He keeps saying, you want a real, easy, practical example of how you know you've passed from death unto life? Keep his commandments. What's a good commandment for me to keep? Oh, love my brothers. You know you passed from death unto life because you walk in light and not in darkness. What's a good example of you coming out of darkness into light? You love your brothers. And now he comes to this reality. He says we're supposed to love one another. How are we supposed to love one another? Start with this body of believers. Start with that small group Sunday school class that you're with every week as you spend time around the Word of God and you work through your struggles in life. Love on each other, encourage one another, strengthen one another. Then we have to ask ourselves the question, do we have hatred towards our brothers? John brings this to light because it's a reality. It's a struggle. We're still encased in flesh. There's still a battle and a war going on. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. I know what I'm supposed to do, but I have a hard time doing it. And so John reminds his audience, if we passed from death to life, we love our brothers. But if there's no love for our brothers, he says we abide in death. And he goes on to say that if we hate our brother, we're a murderer. And if we're a murderer, he says, you know there are not going to be any murderers in heaven. They don't possess eternal life. There's a real practical point of application this morning. Is there somebody, we'll be real broad, is there somebody you hate? Now, let's just get real. Is there somebody in the body of Christ that you have hatred towards? Oh, no, preacher, the Bible says I'm supposed to love everybody. You ever heard this statement before? And I've said it up here before, and this one bothers me. This gets in my craw. I love them because the Bible tells me to, but I don't have to like them. Where's that in here? Well, the Bible says I gotta love everybody. Well, if it's truly love, then guess what? You gotta like me too. Now you don't have to like my ways. You may be tired of my pink tie and my, just one more time, Jill, just one more time. My pink socks. They're not gonna see them if I don't do that. It's the only way it's gonna happen. You may be tired of some of my foolishness. It may be getting old, but you still have to love me. And we have to love one another. And if there's a feeling of ill will, if there is hatred in your heart towards someone, you need to ask the Father a question. God, why do I feel this way? Is there something wrong within me? So many times we're worried about projecting that on everybody else. But God, is there something wrong with me? He says there's a way we can see, and it's the way that we live our lives. We have to love indeed. How do we treat one another? How do we love on one another? He says, we'll know that he's laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. We ought to be willing to be doing good to the body of Christ. We talked about this morning in Sunday school. We're doing our Discover BBC class again and just talking about what it means to be a follower of Christ and real kind of big, broad kind of stuff. And we talked about again in the book of Acts what it means to be a church, things that we ought to be doing together. We ought to be worshiping together. We do it every Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, every Sunday night at 6 o'clock. We worship together. There's times for instruction where we come to Sunday school and you listen to preaching. Those are times for us to be instructed. There's times for fellowship. And I love the fact that some of our classes get together and do things. We had some time in fellowship last night. We got to do some fishing and eating together. We need to do that. Your classes need to be together. We need to fellowship. We need to be doing evangelism. We need to be reaching out with the gospel. As followers of Jesus Christ, we're supposed to be doing all these things, but we're also supposed to be serving one another. Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone. But Paul goes on to say, and especially to those that are of the household of faith. Especially to the body of Christ. I need some thank you note music. Some of y'all got that reference. This week I was blessed to receive two thank you notes. I'm going to read the first one because there's no name on it. I'm waiting for the music to play. Thank you for all you've done, preacher. Amen. Thank you for whoever that was that sent me that thank you note. Then I got this one, so y'all have to pass the word on. Brother Tommy, she's not here. It says, dear preacher, thank you for everything you do for Bowdon Baptist Church, from Sarah Grace Holt. She signed hers. I appreciate that. Took the time to write a note. And y'all are great about that. The phone calls, the emails, the texts, the thank you notes. We need to do that for the body of Christ. We need to keep each other encouraged. Especially, Paul says, to those that are of the household of faith. But Paul says that we ought to be doing good. It ought to be manifesting ourselves as we love on each other. They will know we are Christians by our love. We will know that we are Christians by our love. Here's the reality. There's a struggle. And this is why I felt really impressed by the Holy Spirit to work through 1 John. But there are some of you this morning that are not convinced that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And my job is not to convince you. That's the Holy Spirit. And as we've looked at these things over the past few weeks, as we looked at the importance of following God's commands, moving from darkness unto light, and now getting to a place where we're identifying, and God is challenging us to look at our heart and minds. Are we loving each other the way that we're supposed to? He gets to this ending of this thought process by talking about fact. Over my years of ministry, I've encountered numerous folks that had this mentality. When you would ask them a question, do you know that you have eternal life? Do you know that if you died right now, you would spend eternity in heaven? There are people that will say, well, I sure hope so. Like, no, that's not the God that I serve. He's not a God of hope so. He's a God of know so. That you can know. You don't have to hope. And it's based on fact. The problem a lot of times with salvation and spirituality is so many times it's generated and it's moved by and it's pushed by emotion. Man, I'm walking with Jesus and everything's good if I feel good. But if I don't feel good, maybe something ain't right. And so we talk about it from an emotional standpoint. Man, you read the scriptures, God doesn't want us functioning in an emotional quandary or quagmire, just kind of we're never sure what's going on. He wants us to know that we have eternal life. And we know that we can have eternal life. And that's where he gets into this reality about our heart. Because our heart is a challenge. Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick or desperately wicked. Who can know it? Who can understand it? We need to know that we have eternal life. I love that conversation. I was just kind of learning about the group this morning in my Sunday school class and hearing testimonies and allowing folks to share their testimony. And I love the fact that one of the folks in there said, you know, I remember when I went to Super Wow That, I had a little flashback when we were talking about that story too. I remember super well. It's the Georgia Baptist Convention summer camp down at Jekyll Island. But I remember when I went to Super Wow, and I remember that I gave my life to Christ. And then they went on to say, you know, but I don't remember all the details about it. I don't remember specifically all that went on. And I said, look, I'll be honest with you, when I share my testimony, I talk about knowing the time and the place and all that kind of stuff, because I had a good student pastor, like we're blessed with here with AJ, that said, look, Justin, this is the day that you got saved. Don't forget this day. Remember this day. Always remember this day. Don't forget this day. He kept reminding me to put that in my heart and my head. Don't forget this day. But if you don't remember the day, or you don't remember the hour, if you don't remember all the specifics, that's the problem that John's dealing with here. Sometimes the devil will get us off on all these kind of tangents and thinking, man, I don't know, I'm not sure. And then we get these facts that God brings to us, these truths that he brings to us that we don't have to fight against our heart. God is greater than our heart. His truth is greater than our emotion. We know that we have eternal life because we passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. So here's the question this morning. Do you love us? I mean, honestly, when you walk away from here, you may, I can't wait to get back to be with the body of Christ. Man, I love my brothers and sisters at Bowdon Baptist Church. I love them. Or is there something missing? I mean, is it a positive feeling, or is there something going on? Is there a struggle? Is there a disconnect? Is there a problem? Is there a problem you have with an individual? John's helping us to be real honest here. If we've got a problem with somebody, we need to figure it out. Jesus even talks about it to the level of, if we have a problem with a brother, we're to leave our gift at the altar and go and make things right with our brother before we can even worship. Is there a reason why you're not able to worship on Sunday morning to give glory and honor and praise and to rejoice in Him? Is it because you still have a problem with somebody in this fellowship? You go, oh no, Justin, man, everything's cool in this place. You're crazy if you think that's a reality. We all have struggles. We talked about it last week with sin. We all have issues. And maybe there's somebody this morning that you've got a problem with. You need to go to them. You need to make it right and you need to fix it. I remember when our family was segmented. You don't really find it out until the glue passes away. In our family, it was my grandmother. And I was ignorant. All right? I thought out there everything was hunky-dory. Everything was great. Then my grandmama passed away. Then it all started falling apart. And I remember preaching my grandmother's funeral. And going to my grandmother's house, everybody got together. And all of a sudden, I started feeling this tension. We were having different various conversations around. And my stepdaddy came up to me. He wasn't my stepdaddy. He was my mom's boyfriend. Let's just be real honest. He came over to me and he said something to me, and I don't remember what he said, but I'm a little bit larger. I'm justifying my story. So I was sitting in the chair like this, and he said something to me, and I said, this is how I get up from the chair. He said, oh, you want to take us outside? I said, well, yeah, it's a lot cooler out there than it is in here. So we went outside, and it turned into this big tirade, and there was screaming and hollering, and I thought this old emphysemic man was about to go ballistic on me and start wearing me out in the backyard of my grandmama's house. And I thought, what in the world is going on here? And my mama and him left, and then my aunt and uncle left, and I left sit there just dazed and confused. What in the world is going on? And I finally had to realize that it wasn't his problem. It wasn't my mom's problem. It was my aunt, my uncle's problem. It was none of their problem. You guess who the problem was? Right, wrong. I was the one with the problem. Because as a believer and follower of Jesus Christ, what was my call to do? Forgive. So we tried, and that first time, Jill will tell you, that first time we went over to my mama's house, we sat down with my sister and her husband, the six of us sat around, we didn't get any better. And that first year, we didn't talk to each other on the phone. And we didn't do any birthdays, and we didn't do any gatherings, but we kept calling, and we kept trying to make contact. We kept trying to do some stuff. I kept saying, I'm sorry, I don't know what I've done. I'm trying to figure this thing out. And finally, hey, will you come to so-and-so's birthday? Yeah, I think we're going to come. And there was a lot of tension. There was a lot of frustration. There was a lot of angst, and there was a lot of stuff. But as a follower of Jesus Christ, it fell upon me to go to them and say, I am sorry, I love you, and whatever it is, I'm sorry. Was I justified and was I right? In my heart and mind, absolutely I was. But what difference does it make? I loved her. She's my mama. And the Bible tells us, and this is one of those things that we're running to culturally as Christians, we feel like we have a right, we feel like we're justified. But what the Scripture says here is, what is my responsibility? Love my brothers. My relationship with my mom, the best it's ever been? I would say, yeah, it's better than it's ever been. Did we go through a rough patch? Well, yeah, absolutely we did. But if we really love one another, like the Bible calls us to, it's more important for us to be together than for me to be right. Mama, I'm sorry. I love you, and I want our family back together. Maybe it's not your mama and daddy, but maybe it's a deacon, or maybe it's a Sunday school teacher, or maybe it's somebody that sits on the opposite side of the church from you. Maybe it's not a brother or sister in this congregation or this fellowship, but maybe it's one down the road, down the street. But if you can't come to a point and a place, and it may not be today, but you know mentally and emotionally and spiritually, the Spirit of God is speaking to you, you know that there's going to come this time that you've got to deal with this. That if we really love one another, then that identifies us as followers of Jesus Christ. And so that's the question we have to ask ourselves as followers of Jesus Christ this morning. Are we keeping God's commandment to love one another? Are we being intentional? Not just the ones that are easy to love like me, but all of us. Are we loving each other? And if we're not, why not? Let's pray together this morning. Father, I thank you for the truth that's in your word. Lord, the expectation for us as believers, we which are spiritual, have a greater responsibility. Too much has been given, much is required. Father, the reality is in my story, in my family life, Lord, I know it's not perfect. And Lord, the reality is we still struggle because we're family and we love each other. But Father, you've called us as believers to be different. The world will know we are Christians by our love. Do we really love each other? And Father, as we went through this process this morning of looking at your Scripture and allow the Spirit to move in our hearts and lives, Father, I think there's some of us that need to be real honest that maybe we wouldn't go as far as to say we hate somebody. There's some folks that we don't like. And Father, we really need to allow your Spirit to investigate our heart and ask ourselves the question, first and foremost, do we even have a relationship with Jesus Christ? And if we are, and we're assured of that, we know that by fact because we have a relationship with you. And Father, we really need to investigate our heart and understand why we would have that big of a problem with another human being, and especially someone who's a brother or a sister in the faith. So, Father, I want to pray first and foremost for my brothers and sisters in Christ this morning, where we got to deal with stuff. We can't just allow stuff to be dangling out there. We have to deal with it. Father, if we will not fix it in here, it's going to ravage us, destroy us, the unity will be destroyed, and Father, the church will become a byword as the nation of Israel became. But Father, there's something special when we will acknowledge our sin and be obedient to you. Father, the other reality does sit in this room. There's some men, women, boys, and girls in this room that they do have hatred in their heart towards somewhere else. They do think bad things about other people. And the reality is because they don't know your Son as their Savior. And that's another place we need to be real honest with your Holy Spirit this morning. But as always, wherever we are, we have to do business with you. We have to make a decision. So, Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters that we'll do what we know to do is right. And then, Father, for that man, woman, boy, or girl that doesn't know your Son as their Savior, and that's why they can't love each other. But maybe this morning they give their heart and life to you. But Father, whatever it is in this moment, help us to be obedient to you. Father, we love you. We ask that your will be done. Your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you quietly stand to your feet. Just a moment, Benny's going to come and he's going to sing lead us in an invitational hymn. We'll all sing along. But if you know you need to do business this morning, when we start singing, would you come and pray? Speak to the Lord about what you need to do. Would you be willing to ask for forgiveness, even though you're right? That's the way I was. I was right. But Father, being obedient to you was more important. So in this moment when we sing, if God's laid something on your heart, situation, would you pray? And if you're not a believer, when we sing in just a moment, would you come down front and share that with me? I'd love to pray with you, show you from God's Word what it means to be a follower of Christ. Whatever it is, in this moment, be obedient to Him. Father, we pray again, Thy will be done. We thank you that it is. We pray and ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Benny, what number are we going to sing?
544.
Hymn 544, is the Spirit of God spoken to you. Be obedient to Him this morning.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than
Father, we come before you right now, or I do. I just remember what it was like for me in those couple of years where my family was segmented. Lord, I know I'm not alone. But Father, there may be some folks like that right now. Lord, they may not feel led to come to an altar, but I ask that you would impress upon them their need to pray right now and to see what they need to do to get that situation fixed. Lord, as I stood over Aunt Shirley Wednesday, the reality is that there are a lot of things that don't get completed on this side of eternity because of selfishness and pride. Sometimes those that we love are gone and we don't have an opportunity. So, Lord, I just pray that if somebody's dealing with that, they would just talk to you and allow your Spirit to speak to them. Father, also, I'm keenly aware of the fact that there are some folks that need to be obedient to you in a lot of areas this morning. So I just ask that you would move in their heart and life this morning and help them to be obedient to you. Father, thank you so much for loving us. We pray in Jesus' name. As we sing this last verse, or this next verse of invitation, if Bowdon is the place that God has revealed by Spirit and Word, His Word, you need to be involved in the work of the ministry through membership. We invite you to come and join with us by letter, statement, or baptism as we sing this verse together.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior.
bless you so much, and thank you for being a part of our worship service together this morning. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the blessings of this day. Lord, again, you call us not to be hearers, but to be doers. Whatever that means for us today, may we put it into practice. Father, we love you. Thank you for love. Pray in Jesus' name. We will sing together as we dismiss this morning, Brother Benny.
A closing prayer, make us one.
Thank you.